have a... I can't even get the words out because Doubting Thomas is trying to mess with me. I have a short message for you this morning, believe it or not. But I'm going to need to read at least one chapter in almost the entire chapter in the Bible to give you what God gave me to give you, because I have to breathe life into the word. So I have to be able to read some stuff to you. Is that okay? You don't mind if Pastor actually reads the Bible to you this morning. Is that all right? I mean, we are in church of all places, right? Turn to your Bibles, or open your Bibles, I should say, and turn to 2 Samuel chapter 11. 2 Samuel chapter 11. For those of you who don't know, that is in the Old Testament. I'm teasing. This is a very familiar story. In fact, it's so familiar that I have decided not to read the entire 11th chapter to you, because I really should, in order to give you this the right way. But for the sake of time, I'm not going to do that. Instead, we're just going to focus on chapter number 12. But before I start in chapter 12, I got to back up and frame the context for you, okay? So that's why we're in 11, and we are going to go down to verse 26. Verse 26, and you already know, if you have been scanning ahead, that this message has to deal with the infamous dealings of David and Bathsheba. I like what Minister Mike said last week. This is the kids are put away in Sunday school. Today is for adults. Amen. I'm gonna be honest with you. You should leave your sensitivities in the parking lot because of some of the things that I may end up saying today. Today gets a rating of at least PG-13. It might be NC-17. I'm not sure how I'm gonna handle this, but you got to at least be 13, or, well, I'm not even sure you should be 13. You might need to be 17 to be in church today. But don't worry, I'm gonna button it up pretty good for you. 11:26, here's what it says. And when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband. And when the mourning was past, David sent and fetched her to his house, and she became his wife and bare him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. Everyone here knows what that's about, right? That's the deal that David did. He basically cheated on all his wives that he had already had at that time with one of his best friend's wife, committed adultery. And if that wasn't enough, when the girl got pregnant that he cheated with, he tried to cover it up. And when that didn't work, he went ahead and killed the guy so that he could take her to be his wife and try to slip this thing through with nobody finding out. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. Now, continue reading this story in verse 1 of the next chapter, chapter 12. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, there were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished up, and it grew up together with him and with his children. You see that? This is like Lassie. This is the pet, like, of all pets. This is the one lamb they have. It grows up with him and his children. It did eat of his own meat. He fed the lamb what they ate at the dinner table. It did eat of his own meat and drank from his own cup. Now, I will be honest with you. I'm not too sure about that right there. I can give him some scraps from the table, but he ain't drinking my stuff. Amen. All right. But ate of his own meat and drank from his own cup and lay in his bosom and was unto him as a daughter. He loved that thing like it was his own precious little daughter. And there came a traveler unto the rich man. You see that? Second time he's identifying this guy as having more than enough. And he spared this rich man to take of his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was come unto him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man or the traveler that was come to him. You see how Nathan is describing the outrageousness of this sin? Look at verse 5. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. And he said unto Nathan, as the Lord liveth, the man that hath done this thing shall surely die. And he shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing. And, you see that? And, watch this, because he had no pity. Look at David pronouncing judgment on the sin of this rich man who had more than enough, but decided to steal something from some poor man who didn't have a fraction of what he had. Watch this. And Nathan said to David, thou art the man. I've been talking about you this whole time. Thou art the man. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I anointed thee king over Israel, and I delivered thee out of the hand of Saul, and I gave thee thy master's house and thy master's wives into thy bosom, and gave thee the house of Israel and Judah, both kingdoms. And if that had been too little, listen to what God tells this man, David. If what I have given you, the palace, Saul's wealth, Saul's kingdom, both kingdoms, all the women that you could ever want, I gave all of that stuff to you. And if that had been too little, I would moreover, more and more and more and moreover have given unto thee such and such things. Whatever you ask. I would like a Lamborghini. Well, we can work on that. Boom, I would have given you such and such. If what I have already given you was not enough for you, David. Who say God is against the prosperity of his people? That's right there. That right there is for all you people out there who condemn the prosperity message. I'm not going off on that today, but you should just take a note of what I just read to you. God has no problem with his people prospering. And he just said, I will give you whatever. If what you don't have is enough right now, just ask. I can get you to where you want to be. Wherefore, hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil, note that, evil in his sight. See, God calls a spade a spade. I hope you know that. I hope you don't think that you could just sin as a Christian and God winks at that. Because David was as much Christian as anybody in the Bible. And God just called him evil to his face. How could you do this? How could you despise the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword and hast taken his wife to be thy wife and hast slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon. Now, therefore, because you did that, therefore, the sword shall never depart from thine house because thou hast despised me. Whoa, 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 whoa. I thought he sinned against Uriah. No, you got to know when you sin as a Christian, you're not sinning against the handful of folks you're doing business with down here. You better listen to me, church. When you sin as a Christian, you are smacking and spitting in the face of God. A Christian who sins is personally assaulting God. You better know that about sin. You don't just sin like, oops, I made a mistake. No, you have despised the Lord when you sin. Get that. We play fast and loose with this grace and this Christianity and this freedom and this liberty that we got. You sin against the Lord. Therefore, the sword shall never depart from thine house, because thou hast despised me and hast taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife. Thus saith the Lord, behold, you should underline that, I will raise up evil against thee of thine own house. I will raise up evil against you out of your own house, God says. Well, why would God take such an aggressive approach? Because he's already said, be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever a man soweth, I'm going to make sure he reaps it. And he didn't say whatever a sinner sows. Read your Bible closely. He said whatever any man sows. And that includes the Christian and the non-Christian alike. So you're going to have to reap this, David. Sorry, not sorry. And I will take thy wives before thine eyes and give them unto thy neighbor. And he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of this sun. For thou didst it secretly. But I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun. You thought you were moving and you making some moves and creeping, you know that old TLC song, I creep. Yeah, you thought you were on the creep, right? You thought nobody saw you doing what you were doing. Mm-hmm. You thought that God's eyes don't go to and fro throughout the whole earth to see what his people are getting themselves into. Wrong answer. I saw you when you made the phone call. Get her over here. You did it in secret. I'm going to expose you publicly. Amen. For the whole world to see. Amen. And David said unto Nathan, shoot, I'm caught. No, I'm sorry. He didn't say that. David said, oh, I have sinned against the Lord. I have sinned against the Lord. That's all he said. Notice that. You're right. I totally blew it. I sinned. And I sinned against the Lord. I didn't sin against only Uriah and only Beth. I sinned. Nathan, you're right. I didn't realize the gravity. I didn't realize that this was a personal attack on the Lord. I sinned against the Lord. Look at this. Next word. Nathan said unto David, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. Mark that in your Bible. You need to underline it. You know why? Because that's how lightning fast God forgives us when we repent. Jesus. You better get that, church. David, oh my gosh, I sinned against the Lord, Nathan. I knew it was wrong, but I didn't know I was sinning against the Lord. How could I do this? Don't worry, God forgives you. Just that fast. Did you see it? Just that fast. Don't worry. The Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die. But you still got to reap some stuff. Remember, David. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. The Lord hath put away thy sin. Howbeit, because by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. Somebody's got to pay. You reap what you sow. And because you have this repentant heart, I can't kill you. Somebody's got to pay. Eye for an eye. Blood for blood. You slaughtered your Uriah. Somebody's got to pay. So you know who's going to pay, David? Your brand new baby. That's who's going to pay. And Nathan departed unto his house, and the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bare unto David, and it was very sick. David therefore besought God for the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night upon the earth. And the elders of his house arose and went unto him to raise him up from the earth, but he would not, neither did he eat bread with them. And it came to pass on the seventh day that the child died. And the servants of David feared to tell him that the child was dead, for they said, behold, while the child was yet alive, we spake unto him, and he would not hearken unto our voice. How will he then vex himself now if we tell him the child is dead? When he was alive, at least David was trying to fight for the kid. He didn't eat, he didn't fast, and he wouldn't be consoled. I mean, he was at least clinging to humanity and life. What's going to happen if we go tell him the baby died? We don't know what may happen. He may hang himself. It may be too much for him. We saw how out of his mind he was just a week ago. But when David saw that his servants whispered, David perceived that the child was dead. Therefore, David said unto his servants, is the child dead? And they said, he is dead. Then David arose from the earth and washed and anointed himself and changed his apparel, came into the house of the Lord and worshiped. My God in heaven, I have been there before. I've lost one and had to go to the house of God and worship through the pain and the sorrow of loss. David went to the house of the Lord and worshiped. Then he came to his own house. And when he required, they set bread before him and he did eat. Then said his servants unto him, what thing is this that thou hast done? Thou didst fast and weep for the child while it was alive. But when the child is dead, thou didst rise up and eat bread. And he said, while the child was yet alive, I fasted and wept. For I said, who can tell whether God will be gracious to me that the child may live? Who can tell? Who knows? God is so merciful and great. I just might be able to persuade him to spare the baby. I'm going to fight for this child's life as best I can. I don't care what the doctors say. Cancer is terminal. I must still believe God. Who knows whether or not God's going to change the verdict? But now he is dead. Wherefore should I fast? Can I bring him back again? No. I shall go to him, but he shall not return to me. I'll see him again, just not down here. Now pay close attention. We've come to the end of the story for the most part, but we've also come to the very reason I'm reading this entire story to you. Listen to the conclusion that was written by the Holy Ghost. Listen. Verse 24. And David comforted Bathsheba, his wife, and went in unto her and lay with her, and she bare a son. And he called his name Solomon. And the Lord loved him. Please underline that and highlight it if you got one. Please underline that right there. And the Lord loved him. Watch this. So much so. Look at verse 25. And he, God, sent by the hand of Nathan the prophet, and he called his name Jedidiah, because of the Lord. You see that? God sent word by Nathan the prophet to tell David to change the boy's name to Jedediah, not Solomon, because he loved him so much. Here, listen to it in the New Living Translation. This is how the New Living renders that. And God sent word through Nathan the prophet that they should name him Jedediah, which means beloved of the Lord, as the Lord had commanded. Stop right there. I'm done reading. I didn't give you the title of this message, so I suppose I'll do that now. Write this down. Write this down. A message to the backslider. Why are you running from God? This is a message to the backslider. Why on earth are you running from God? Oh, you better not use backslider, Pastor, because people don't think they're backslidden. You're right. So let me clean that up a little bit. If you're not a backslider, if you don't think this message is for you, a message to the unfaithful Christian, a message to the Christian with some hangups, with some faults, some mistakes he or she has made along the way. Why are you running from the Lord? All right, now I have thoroughly diagnosed everybody in this building. Amen. Adam and Eve, why are you hiding from the Lord? When he loves you, no matter what. Jesus. That's the whole message right there. We can literally go home right now. I'm done. I really am done. That was the whole message. Why are we always running from God? Especially when he loves us no matter what. I mean, let's be honest. Talk to me, church. What sin could we possibly commit that God won't forgive us? Verse 24, don't take my word for it. Just look at the text. Verse 24 says, the Lord loved Solomon. So much so that he personally changed the boy's name to Jedediah, which means beloved of the Lord. One who is beloved, really, really loved by the Lord. There was another guy who was known to be beloved by the Lord. His name was Daniel. Only two people in this whole Bible that get that title. And yet, here we have David and Bathsheba and this gross sin that they committed. How about this? Try wrapping your mind around this. All of what I just read to you leading up happened. And we know it happened. And David and the cover-up and all of that. He has another son. And the Holy Ghost says, God really, really, really loved that boy. That's mind-blowing to me. That when I read that, I was just reading this in a personal study of mine, just reading. And then I stopped dead in my tracks. Wait a minute. And the Lord really, really, really loved this boy? We just read the sordid account of how Solomon got here. Come on, church, you know what I'm talking about. He is the offspring of adultery and murder. And oh, by the way, both of those sins are capital crimes in God's book. Punishable immediately by death. You get caught in adultery, we take you right down to the edge of the town, picking up as many big rocks as we can and lopping them things upside your head until you breathe no more. And you already know you murder somebody, it's a wrap. We're doing the same thing to you. Punishable by death. And yet the Holy Ghost compels the prophet to write in this sacred book that God actually loves this heinously sinful stain on the nation. I hope you get this, church. This scandalous blemish, this horrible and unavoidable reminder of what a perverse love triangle really looks like. What a warped mind and some untamed or unbridled passions look like. That's Solomon. For better or for worse, like it or not, he was the shameful product of murder and adultery. And somehow, your Bible declares God really loved him. Jesus, my God. The Bible says God loved him some Solomon. That's how we would say it down in the South. So just forgive me if I break into a little Southern colloquialism from time to time. God loved him some Solomon. Can you believe that? Get a hold of that this morning, church. That's the message. That's the word God gave me to give you. See, we don't fully appreciate God's unconditional love. I'll tell you something else we don't fully appreciate. We don't fully appreciate that God's love is redemptive. Ooh, what do you mean by that, Pastor? I mean redemptive. There's some redeeming quality about his love. There's something in his love that tries to redeem. He doesn't just love to love. He's loving, of course, to love and to shower affection on you. But his love overlooks. His love redeems. His love buys back. His love cancels sin. His love is ever reaching to bring the sinful to him. His love is redemptive. As a matter of fact, even his judgment is redemptive when you think about it. Ask Noah. Ask Noah. Exhibit A is Noah. Yes, he punished the entire world for sin, but he saved Noah, didn't he? He still found a way to redeem Noah, didn't he? Isn't that right? He punished the whole nation of Israel for their murmuring and complaining and let them wander in the wilderness for a whole 40 years, a whole generation, and they died and they never were able to enter the promised land. But he made room for Joshua and Caleb, didn't he? See, even his judgment is redemptive. Come on, church. He let Saul wreak havoc on the church, Mike, persecuting Christians. Saul of Tarsus. But he got a hold of that same Saul and turned him into an incredible apostle. Saul did it blindly. You know how good God's sense of humor is? Saul was blinded by the Old Testament, by the customs of the Pharisees and the religious strict adherence to the rule of law. And he didn't see the grace of Jesus Christ embedded within the scriptures. Messiah was embedded in the whole Old Testament, and he didn't really get that. He was blinded to Messiah, actually looking for the Messiah to come. Jesus right there in front of him, blinded to the Messiah. So God just temporarily blinded him. This is how God redeems. You see, you reap what you sow. You blind. So God blinded him for 3 days until finally he got a clue. And then he sent them forth preaching in the name of the very one he destroyed lives for, Jesus. Formerly persecuting people for calling that name. And he's sitting up in church on Sunday, Saturday, whatever. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. See, God's love, just like his judgment, indescribable, limitless, unconditional. His love is without bounds. And I need everyone in this church and everyone watching on this live stream to get that. The love of God is so far reaching, you can't even conceive. Yes. Some of us were pulled out of some very, 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 let me just say, shady backgrounds. the love of God was able to reach us all the way there. My God. I'll say this. How shall I say this? The Bible says, let me just say this. The Bible says God loved Solomon. He loved Solomon. What gets me about the text that I just read to you is how the Bible makes a point to say how much God truly loved Solomon. He could have just said God loved Solomon and went on. He said God loved Solomon. Then he grabbed Nathan. I have a prophecy for you. Go back to David. Go into his house and tell him, thus says the Lord, I really love that boy. Change his name. Do you understand the depth? I mean, that's saying something. I mean, I need you to understand that is really, really, really saying something. I already told you what the name Jedediah means. It's translated beloved of the Lord. Truth be told, that God even gave David and Bathsheba a second chance is remarkable. Come on, church. How many of you would have given those, I don't want to call them dirt bags, but how many of you would have given them a second chance? They done committed all this adultery and murdered the man. Maybe not they. I shouldn't say David was the lead conspirator in all of this. And I'm not trying to beat a dead horse, but we have to remember, listen, David didn't just commit adultery. He committed first degree premeditated murder. There was no accident. He said, put Uriah at the front of the line so he can be killed. He wrote that in a letter. If that letter was ever produced in court, it's over for David. Guess what, folks? David had to live with the consequences of those actions. Did you ever think about that? No. Think about it. I thought about it. We forget. I read it to you a moment ago. David married the stolen wife of Uriah. Jesus. You got to get this. He married the stolen wife, the widow of the man he murdered. He married her. And watch this, Mike. Even after Nathan outed him, he remained married to her. Jesus. You better listen to me, church. You never saw this like I saw it. I'm telling you right now. Even after Nathan declares to everyone in earshot, you did that horrible thing, he stayed married to her. He even stayed married to her after the first baby died. After the Lord takes the first baby, David never annulled his marriage to Bathsheba. Think about what I'm telling you. He didn't try to undo it. Amen. The Bible never says he put her away or they got a divorce or he annulled the marriage or he sent her out and banished her to some like, all right, I made this mistake. I'm going to clean it up. I'm going to make this thing right. You go over there and I'm going to go over here and I'm going to. None of that. Not at all. David knew it was a cover-up, a sham marriage to begin with. You know how we do when immigration comes around and oh, I forgot, I got some foreigners in this church. I better clean this up. Well, you know how they do when immigration comes around and they want to check to make sure y'all really married, or was this a little convenient thing for a green card? This was a sham marriage every day of the week. David had to live with that shame. That's the point I'm getting to. They had to live with this shame every day. Everyone knowing their business. Everyone looking at them side-eyed. You know what you did was wrong. I can't believe you. And you got the nerve to be married to her on top of that. See, that's how they would talk in our community. And watch this, PT. Side-eyed. You know everybody from Joab the general on down to all the captain of the royal guard, all his secret service, everybody in that palace looking at David like, with a whole bunch of contempt and disgust. You know why? Because now there are only 39 mighty men when there used to be 40. Jesus. And Joab was the leader of the 40. Excuse me, now 39. And David makes Joab a partner in his crime. You want me to kill one of our best friends? Are you out of your mind? Well, I know I better listen to you, because the same way you can order his death sentence, you come right for me. One of his own elite soldiers, David just assassinated him. You better know. All those 39 mighty men that were left, it was all they could do to keep themselves from putting David in a blender. I'm telling you right now, those boys were Navy SEALs for all intents and purposes. That's why they get the designation David's Mighty Men. You've read about the exploits that some of those guys did. I taught just a few weeks ago about how they broke through the defensive lines of the Philistines just to get David a pitcher of water from a well near Bethlehem. Two or three guys, I think it was, fought through a whole army, the whole front line, just to draw some water for David. Their exploits are absolutely insane. You better know. They were doing everything in their power to keep from assassinating David, turning over a coup in this government, because David messed around and betrayed one of their inner circle. It was David and his 40 mighty men. These were the most loyal and faithful men in all Israel. If you remember the Bible and you remember the story of David, they were the ones hiding in those caves with David. They were the ones wandering in the wilderness with David. The Bible called them broke and depressed. They were living in depression, broke without any money, following David all those years. He was on the run from Saul. And now they finally, the promise is true and he's the king and everybody's happy and we're doing this thing for God. And he turns around and puts the knife in the back of one of those guys. These are the same guys that took Ziklag back when it was burned to the ground. And they rescued all their women, all their wives, all their children, all their belongings. That's who he did this to. That's who David did this to. They were supposed to be an impenetrable brotherhood. And David goes and does something desperately wicked. You think about what I'm saying. See, this is what's not written in the story that is in the story. David does, without doubt, the worst thing that he could ever do to any man, let alone one of his best friends. Let alone one of his tried and true, his ride or die, as the kids say. Guys that's been in the trenches with him, fought enemies, came close to death for him and with him. David goes, steals, and essentially rapes one of his best friend's wives. Crazy. And then murders the guy in cold blood. And then takes her and marries her to cover it up. And brings her to his house so nobody knows. That's the reality that David and Bathsheba are now walking around Israel in the grocery stores. Well, they ain't groceries, but you know what I mean. That's what they're saying about them on Channel 5, on Fox 5. Mm-hmm. And to add insult to injury, along comes Nathan the prophet, right? And puts them on blast, as the kids say. And he publishes it. Fox 5, it's Channel 7, NBC, ABC, everybody knows. Thou art the man that did all of this craziness. The Inquirer's running with the story. The Times put the big picture of David. You know, the big eye picture, like when you get caught, like they find that one picture of you in your worst moment. And then David loses the first baby, the innocent little child that had nothing to do with its parents' foolishness. It had nothing to do with any of that wickedness. Didn't ask to be born, didn't ask to be conceived, didn't ask to get mixed up in David's sordid mess. Its fragile little life snatched away, Jesus, because of David's deplorable sins. You talk about low. I'm going to tell you right now, there's nothing lower than the loss of a child for a parent. There's no comparing that loss to any other loss ever. It just isn't. Not the loss of a spouse, not the loss of a parent, not the loss of a sibling, nothing. If you're a father or a mother and you lose one of your little babies, there's nothing worse. I'm not saying those other losses aren't debilitating. I'm not saying they're not insufferable. I'm not saying that, but trust me, I know. There's nothing like the loss of a child. Nothing compares to it. Especially after you waited 9 months, almost a year, just for the little baby to arrive. But all this anticipation, and they finally pop it out and they give it to you, it's yours, and you instantly fall all over in love with this baby again. Oh, he's got your eyes, he's got your nose, and your big ears, and dressing a kid up in all these pretty clothes, and just you just love the thing. Just you could eat him if you would. I mean, just cheeks and pinch the cheeks and just and all of that. I know what I'm talking about. I've seen it up close and personal in my own family, half a dozen times easily. In fact, I remember a few years back. It's been a little bit now. It's been more than 10 years now, but I had a good friend. I did the funeral for a good friend who lost twins. I think they had gotten to be 7 months or so, I think. And something happened, and the babies had to come out premature, and they lost them a few days later, just like in David's case. Can I tell you, I didn't even know they made coffins that small. I didn't even know. I was ignorant. I had no idea. I trembled when I saw those little 3-foot coffins, because then it hit me because I knew what was on the inside. Like, they make little wooden boxes. They're only this big. And you see that's a kid in there. And I had to watch and observe my friend literally walk through the valley of the shadow of death as he had to bury his twins. I've seen a lot of death in my life. I've been crippled by death plenty times in my life. It changes you. There's something about death that changes you. It just does. And I was changed forever when I saw that. It was devastating. And they expected me to share some words of comfort standing over these 3-foot wooden pine boxes. So I didn't understand what David and Bathsheba are dealing with right now in this text. I have a very good read on their mindset. Amen. I have a pretty good idea what their emotional state of mind was right here. David and Bathsheba were in the depths of despair. Their sin had dug a grave for them from which their baby would not arise. And I know they must have felt as if they were unable to go on. that David could go to church and worship is beyond me. I'm certain they felt like their sins had ruined everything in their lives and their lives were over. And then along comes verse 24. God loved Solomon. Ooh, get this, church. I'm wrapping up. I'm almost done. God loved him some Solomon. After all of the scandal and the bad name and the reputation going to pot, as we used to say, and the pain and the loss of baby number one, God loves Solomon. I have a question. How is that even possible? Talk to me, church. How is that even possible? Solomon is baby number two from the same two bad people who created baby number one. Steal fruit from the poisonous tree, if you will, Big Mike. How is it possible that God would love Solomon? Solomon, baby number two, from the same perverse, adulterous, murderous relationship. Deacon, he's just the other shoe to drop. From this same twisted and scandalous Hollywood tale. He's just the other shoe to drop. First one dropped a few years ago. Now, here's the other one. Baby number two. So how is it possible that God could even like the boy, let alone really, 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 really love him when you consider David's shenanigans? God vowed the first child wouldn't live, did he not? Did he not? So how is it possible? Did God just forget? Did he have amnesia? Did somebody pull a fast one on him and say, no, this is not the same David. These are not the droids you're looking for. Did they use the Jedi mind trick on God? These are not the droids you're looking for. This is not the David that did all that bad stuff, God. Okay, it's not the David that did all that bad stuff. How? I'll tell you how. Because God is married to the backslider. Jesus. That's how. Isaiah 3:14, some of you who missed that, on maybe you're watching and you don't know what I'm talking about. That's what Isaiah the prophet said. You may not be familiar with that. Isaiah 3:14 says this, "Turn, O backsliding children, saith the Lord, for I am married unto you." You see that, child of God? God is married to the backslider. Jesus. God is in covenant relationship with a backslider. Turn, O backsliding children, saith the Lord, for I am married unto you. Guess what? None of our backsliding can blot us out of his covenant. You know what a marriage is, right? You know what a marriage is all about. The two become one, right? You know that. They become one another's. Forever. You know, till death do us part. You know the vows, right? Exactly. Well, God just said, that's how I regard all of my children. We are one. We are one till death do us part, and I bring you home to live with me in heaven forever. We are one. I'm married to you. You can't pry me away. There is no such thing as divorce to God. In fact, there's another scripture in Isaiah, same prophet, same God. He says this, the word that has gone out of my mouth, watch this, shall not return unto me void, but it shall do what? Accomplish what I sent and prosper in the thing, right? In other words, if I said it, if I gave a covenant on it, it will never break. I will never break my covenant. It is unbreakable. So if I just said that I'm covenant, I'm gonna make up a word here, covenantally married to you, then we are going to be married for eternity. It's fixed. It's unalterable. It is unbreakable, in other words. That's what God's covenant is with us, Christians. If he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you, then he means I will never leave you nor forsake you. Amen. Period, end of story. So I have a question for you, church. I have a question for you, backslider. I'm sorry, Christian with some hangups. Christian with a few faults. Christian who's messed up a few times and maybe hasn't gotten it all right yet. I got a question for you. What have you done that's so bad? What have you done that is so bad? Why are you running from God? Jesus. Don't worry, I'll answer my own question. You've not done anything worse than David. I'm pretty sure about that. And if you did, I still got news for you. God loves Solomon. Jesus, Jesus. That's the one thing he told me to tell you this morning. God loved him some Solomon. You haven't done anything that God can't forgive you. You need to come back to the Lord. That's it. Amen. God, do you realize God stopped the entire story? This whole story he was telling about David. The whole, and this is all a part of the history. This is a part of the history of the king. So this is a part of the national narrative. This is almost like our archives in Congress to them. God stopped the whole story just to say and make a point and let the whole world, hey, but I love Solomon. Despite where he came from, despite how he got here, despite all of the nefarious activity by his parents, I love Solomon. And oh, by the way, it wasn't just in word either. You know, like we do sometimes, love you, God bless you, love you, you know, that kind of love. No, this was real love. God shows it. He proves how much he loves Solomon. He backs up his word. He makes him one of the greatest men, if not the greatest man to ever walk on the face of this earth, Jesus aside. No one was wiser than Solomon. He made him the wisest man. No one was ever richer than Solomon. Solomon had like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of billions. Not this little 40 billion that you see these guys. You do a study, you find out what the current exchange rate is. You'll find out when he built the temple, the temple that he built with all the gold was like 40 billion. Just the church, forget his house, his palace. The man had hundreds of what would be equivalent to our billions. He probably actually was in the trillions, to be honest with you. Nobody's ever been richer than him. Nobody's ever been wiser than him. None of that. God made him the greatest man to ever step foot on the planet. And God did that. Get this, church. He did all that for a backstabbing, murderous, filthy, adulterous, lying, cheating, stealing, no good thief who stole his best friend's wife, Jesus. So I ask you again, what could you have possibly done? What could you have possibly done that cannot be overcome? Watch this New Testament Christian church. What could you have possibly done that can't be overcome by Jesus's post-Calvary love for you? Post-Calvary. He died for the sins of the world, every last one of them. What could you have possibly done that his love cannot overcome? Romans 8:38, For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. What can separate us from the love of God? Not life, death, demons, angels, nothing. Not one thing. Not, indeed, not even anything in this entire world, he just said. So, backslider, unfaithful Christian, Christian who's missed a few marks along the way, Christian with a bunch of hang-ups, Christian who hasn't figured it all out yet and got it all together yet. Why are you running from God instead of running to Him? Why are you letting this momentary lapse of judgment? You made a mistake, a sin. Why are you letting that momentary lapse of judgment, that uncharacteristic blunder? Yeah, you dropped the ball, big ball. It was stupid. You did it. You shouldn't have. Why are you letting this sin and this shortcoming separate you or keep you from a Father that loves you that much? Why are you letting it keep you from making things right with the Lord and whoever else you need to make them right with? Better still, see, it's not so much that you have strayed. Ooh, get this, church, get this. It's not so much that you have strayed. It's more so the question, why are you choosing to stay away? Jesus. So what, you got lost? We all get lost along the way sometime. But right now, you're not lost. You're choosing to stay away. That's the difference. If you were just lost, we could pray for you and you could pray and God, the moment David figured, oh my God, I sinned, God forgave him. See, it's not lost. You're choosing to stay lost. You're choosing to stay lost. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anybody opens unto me the door, I will come in and I will sup. I'll have supper. We can be friends again. We can get this thing patched up. I told you a couple weeks ago, but if you never open the door, I'm going to stay on the outside of that door looking in, Jesus says, dreaming of what could have been. Behold, I stand with outstretched arms. That's what Isaiah says. It's Isaiah chapter 65, I believe. With my arms open wide, he says, all the day long, from sunup to sundown. Come home. We can fix whatever you got yourself into. With outstretched arms, he says. Why aren't you responding? Why do you keep ignoring me? Why is your heart so hard now? How did you let things get to this point? Today. You hear me, church? Today is the day. Yes. The writer of Hebrews says, harden not your heart. You don't even know what you got in store for you in the next hour. Oh, you think I got plans to go play basketball or go hang out with such and such or go to the movies or whatever you do on the weekend. That's not guaranteed. Today is the day. Harden not your hearts. You hear me? You need to get back. You need to know when God is calling you out. You need to appreciate when God is calling you back to Himself. Don't ignore Him. Get back to your place in God. backslider, Christian with a few hang-ups. Get back to your place in God. Get back to the house of God.
Amen.
Harden not your hearts. I'm done, but I need to pray for you. I told you, I'm done. I need to pray for someone who is honest enough and unafraid enough to admit, you know what, Pastor, you were speaking to me today. That message was for me. I've drifted away a little bit. I've allowed sin to cause a little division between me and the Lord. I never saw the depths of his unfailing love like I did today. David is an example of the worst of the worst of the worst. And yet God still loved Solomon in spite of all of that. Because there's nothing that will ever separate us from his love. And if we're separated, it's not his fault. He stands waiting. It's our fault. All we got to do is come back. So I heard you today, Pastor. You were speaking right to me. God loves me in spite of all my inexcusable mistakes. And I made quite a few of them. God loves me in spite of my many downfalls, just like he loved Solomon. So the reality is the only thing stopping the reconnection is me. Come on, church. That's it. But not another day. Today is the day. Do not harden your heart. Today is the day. God is pleading with you. Let this be the day you choose to soften that old hardened heart and come back. Respond to the Lord. Make things right. Put things back on track today. Amen?
Amen.
How many of you are in agreement with me with that? Bow your heads, let's pray. And for those of you watching, I want you to bow your heads as well. Because I'm certain that this is for you as much as it is for us in here. All the eyes closed, everybody's heads bowed. Raise your hand if you know you got to get some things right today and you're not going to leave this building today before you get them right. Let me see your hands. I see those hands. I see that hand too. I see that hand. Amen. Here's what we're going to do. And I'm sure you out there who are watching, I'm sure you raised your hand as well. Here's what we're going to do. We're all going to pray a simple prayer. David showed us, Lord, I sinned. And immediately Nathan said, the Lord forgives you. We're going to pray a simple prayer. Lord, we're going to ask him to forgive us. Whatever the hang up, whatever the mistake, whatever, whatever, whatever. And it's going to be right today in about 30 seconds. And you're going to leave this place without that weight and all that sin and all that wickedness on your shoulders. It's going to be gone because that's how lightning fast God deals with it. And then from this moment forward, you're going to move forward. You're going to forget that you ever made that mistake. You're going to, if you have to, go clean it up with somebody. You'll do that. You'll take care of that. But then you're just going to move forward. You're going to move forward and life is going to get better and you're not going to have this dead weight hanging around your neck anymore. So let's just pray, everybody who raised their hand especially, but everybody in the building, because we're a family church. And one thing I know is we're all in this together. So I don't single out anybody because it could be me praying this prayer right now. In fact, it is me praying this prayer right now. We're all in this together. So everybody repeat after me. You who are watching on television or the computer or the phone or the internet or whatever device you have, pray this prayer with us as well. Repeat after me. Father, in Jesus' name, I have sinned just like David. And I realize now that my sin was primarily against you. So I'm asking you to forgive me right now. Just erase every wrong thing I've done with the blood of Jesus. Blot it out. And the Bible says you will remember it no more. And the Bible says you'll forgive me if I ask you. I've asked you, and now I receive your forgiveness. And I'm asking you in Jesus' name, excuse me, give me the grace to move forward from all these mistakes from this point forward. If I have to make it up with somebody, help me do that. If I have to leave it and just never deal with it again, give me the willpower to make a clean break so I can go on. In the mighty name of Jesus, thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for restoring fellowship. And thank you now for helping me as I move forward. And thank you for accepting me back and establishing the reconnection. I know you love me as much as you love Solomon. And I'm so grateful for all of your love. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Give God some praise for that.